We're going to be talking about Rush Limbaugh, who has had an outsized role in the media landscape. And so let's just begin. Rush Limbaugh's program is broadcast from 600 radio stations dotting the map of the United States. And it looks kind of like a bad case of measles when you look at it, because it covers almost all of the East Coast, Midwest, and West Coast. And it reaches about 15 million people weekly. Limbaugh was the most successful radio personality in terms of listeners and distribution. He has, since the late 1980s, peddled a brand of far-right extremism and misinformation with a level of certainty that disarms the listener. Limbaugh's three-hour tours of his mind synchronized the thinking of millions of Americans and laid the groundwork for a huge expansion of right-wing audiences and media outlets. Limbaugh was awarded the Medal of Freedom by President Trump. Limbaugh laid the ground for Trump's rise and the mainstreaming of the far right. According to Forbes, Limbaugh's net worth is or was $600 million, his annual income, $87 million, second only to Howard Stern's deal with Sirius XM. Limbaugh's broadcasts were a stream of consciousness, which blended distorted renderings of public events and highly bigoted attacks on the various component parts of the center and left of the political spectrum. Known as a racist, sexist, homophobic, and transphobe, he also was a skilled orator. He rose to national fame at a transition point in American media. Joining us to discuss Limbaugh's legacy is Steve Rendall, co-author of The Way Things Aren't, Rush Limbaugh's Reign of Error, which is a fact-based response to Limbaugh's bigoted book, The Way Things Ought to Be. Steve was also the director of research at the media activist group Fairness and Accuracy in Reporting, or FAIR for short. He recently wrote an article for FAIR.org titled, Limbaugh Helped Create the Conservative Movement and Paved the Road for Trump. Welcome to Out FM, Steve.
Oh, it's great to be here, John. It's always great to be back on WBAI too, where I co-hosted Counterspin for 20 years with people that I'm sure you know, Laura Flanders, Janine Jackson. But it's always great to be back on BAI.
When people talk about right-wing talk radio, they think of Rush Limbaugh. How and why did Limbaugh rise to fame? What were the ingredients?
Well, it's important to point out that he didn't launch. He wasn't the first right-wing talk radio host. Talk radio was really born in 1960 on a station in St. Louis and on KABC in Los Angeles. And it was almost always right-wing talkers when it was political, as opposed to a cooking show or a personal advice show. It was almost always right-wing. So in 1988, Rush Limbaugh, who had a very successful local show in Sacramento on KFBK, went national. And there's a number of reasons for this. But in 1988, when Limbaugh went national, he was really a phenomenon. He was a very talented broadcaster. He had a way of really, really connecting with a lot of his disaffected listeners. Very good at radio. His few sojourns into television didn't work out very well. But, within quick, short order, he was on 250 stations by 1992, 1993. And as you mentioned, his show, by 1997 or 8, he was on 650 stations and maintained most of those stations until his death on February 17th.
Well, wasn't there also a transition point where AM radio changed formats that helped the rise of these national right-wing broadcasters?
Yes.
Can you talk about that?
Yes, yes. It's important to point out that a lot of times the right and the left claim that the reason that talk radio had this explosive growth was because of the Fairness Doctrine, because in 1987, Ronald Reagan scrapped something called the Fairness Doctrine, which was a rule and a law for the FCC. And it required that stations broadcast controversial shows about public affairs, and that they do it by offering a variety of viewpoints. the right and the left argue that Limbaugh's growth and the growth of talk radio was because Reagan scrapped this doctrine. That is not really true, because talk radio thrived locally under the fairness doctrine for decades before Reagan scrapped it. It was never the subject of any FCC decision. Talk radio was always seen as comporting, as complying with the fairness doctrine, because it allowed for callers to call up and challenge the hosts. The reason that talk radio went from a very profitable local format to a national format is threefold. One is that you had music formats. Music fled the AM dial. Music went to the FM dial. FM had higher fidelity. It was better for music. So that left a lot of gaps in stations scheduling, and program directors were looking for something to fill that space with. And news is expensive. It costs money to produce news. It costs money to produce really fine radio documentaries and shows, as you guys know. And so what happened was they looked to these local talk show hosts who were cheap. And one of the two other things that made it that came together with this, with FM radio becoming the home of music, was that satellite technology and telephone 800 numbers became more sophisticated and were able to easily be applied to these national talk radio shows. There was a couple of talk radio shows before Rush Limbaugh. Larry King had one of the few non-right-wing talk radio shows that dealt with politics on the air. But it really was this confluence of things. It was the availability on the AM dial, the cheapness of talk radio. It was very cheap to fill time with a talker, where you have to pay for any royalties for playing songs or anything like that. And the 800 numbers and the satellite technology. And that's what really caused the explosion. And the reason that it ended up being almost all right-wing talk radio shows is because the local hosts that they brought up sort of to the major leagues of national radio, the local hosts were lean to the right to begin with.
Well, let's take a look back at like some of the important current affairs that occurred during the period when Rush Limbaugh was beginning, and that are particularly relevant to the LGBTQ communities and communities of people that have higher incidence of HIV/AIDS. So by 1990, AIDS deaths in the United States topped 100,000, and there was no effective treatment that would stop the disease. Limbaugh's attitude towards people with AIDS was scorn, and he reveled in the ever-increasing toll of illness and death. He mocked sex education for young people on how to save them from infection and death. Let's hear Rush Limbaugh, in his own words, attacking the use of tax money to be spent on AIDS and AIDS prevention.
Then they dare tell us that it's our fault for wanting to keep more of the money we earn and not surrender it in taxes. Working people are striving against the odds to make it in this country, and all the government can do is view them as a revenue target. While picking their pockets, the government has the audacity to foist a guilt trip on them to boot. They're made to feel responsible for everything. Look at AIDS, a terrible disease, but it's largely behaviorally spread. Yet all we hear is that people aren't doing enough about it. Well, there's one simple thing that could be done about it. People could stop around. Instead, the kids of God-fearing parents are handed condoms at school, and they're told, "We know you're just a bunch of little minks. We can't stop you from exploring your sexuality and doing wrong and dangerous things. So here, take this condom and protect yourself." In many school districts, parents aren't even allowed a say in the matter. Well, if the schools are so serious, what they ought to do is convert the study hall to a giant bedroom with beds and clean sheets, have the principal and the school nurse demonstrate to every couple how to use a condom, and then observe them to ensure they do it right. Hell, we may as well go all the way. In fact, if the schools are so certain that kids are going to do this, what they ought to do is find disease-free hookers and bring them in, teach a little supply and demand. I mean, we're getting to the point where the tax producers will someday be outnumbered by the tax eaters of society. Those who choose to accept the responsibilities of life have had enough of being told that they should give more to those who don't shoulder those responsibilities. We're supposed to feel sorry for this group and that group, for the downtrodden, for Native Americans, for those who suffered because Columbus landed. What about feeling sorry for those who are living, who pay the taxes? Those are the people no one ever feels sorry for. They're asked to give and give until they have no more to give.
And so that was Rush Limbaugh. We're having a conversation with Steve Rendall from Fairness and Accuracy in Reporting. While AIDS was raging in the 1980s and 90s, the government was doing little. Groups like ACT UP were out in the streets at school board meetings, raising the issues of prevention and demanding government action and funding. ACT UP's die-in at St. Patrick's Cathedral in New York created a polarizing event, insisting that the Catholic Church stop blocking HIV prevention education, but did not stop with actions alone. Large part of the work of the group was in educating the public using those actions combined with facts. In large part, Rush's show was based on a right-wing reaction to the various grassroots mobilizations of different movements. And it acted as a buffer to kind of support and maintain the social order. But ultimately, it could only slow progress, not prevent it. Rush Limbaugh had hosted a segment called AIDS Update on his radio show, which cynically would begin with songs like I Know I'll Never Love This Way Again, a song popularized by Dionne Warwick, the New Jersey-born singer who was one of the first celebrities to publicly announce her support to combat HIV in the 1980s. After Limbaugh played the song, it was followed by a cruel celebration of the deaths of people with AIDS. Let's hear a little bit of Dionne Warwick.
Inside my fantasies and made each one come true. Something no one else had ever found a way to do. I've kept the memories one by one since you took me in. I know I'll never love this way again.
Steve Rendall, you formerly were research director of FAIR, and you had heard this AIDS update segment, or several of them, live, and it was reported by a lot of print media. Can you describe the kinds of things you heard back in the 80s or early 90s on this show?
Well, let me point out that the earlier clip that you played with about condoms, Rush, among his many things in our initial report on him, we pointed out that he said that condoms didn't work, which was an incredible blow to public health and to, you know, he was on 600 stations. They're licensed with a public trust. They have a license that says that they need to serve the public interest, and he's putting on this dangerous information. I don't remember them very well. Unfortunately for Limbaugh researchers, everybody knows that the AIDS updates, that there's not really any audio record of them. They were reported on in real time by the Minneapolis Star Tribune and the Los Angeles Times, and I heard several of them. He would use not only I'll Never Love This Way Again, Back in the Saddle Again. He had a whole bunch of different songs. He would celebrate deaths. He'd celebrate deaths of people from HIV. I should say flagship station in New York City was owned first by Capital Cities at this point. And then a little later, and he was still, he was going after marriage equality up until he died. And these were stations owned, like WABC in 1996, Disney bought it, you know, the family-friendly Disney. This was outrageous, and it was more or less all flying under the radar of the mainstream media. I mean, in their in their radio segments, they would report in the radio columns, they would report that there was this phenom on the air. He was a right winger and he's very entertaining, and the conservatives really loved him. And in 1994, he was made an honorary member of Congress. He was thought to have helped the Gingrich Revolution come into place. That was in 1994 when the Republicans took back the House for the first time in 40 years. So he was making a difference, but he was getting very little play in very little scrutiny, I should say, in the press that should have been looking at this stuff, not only because it was rank bigotry, but also because it was dangerous. It was disinformation that was a harm to public health.
And in terms of the AIDS update, that was yanked from the air at a certain point. Can you explain why?
At some point, I think some of, you know, maybe Nancy Reagan's friends or I'm not sure who, but somebody had a talk to him. I think it might've been Ed McLaughlin, who was the producer that brought him from the local KFBK in Sacramento to the big time. I think I did hear the rumor that McLaughlin talked to him and said, that's really not flying very well. But it wasn't on his own. I mean, he had to be told to do it. And to tell you the truth, he loved attacking people that were down. I mean, he had something called a homeless update, which he would put on all the time too. He'd use an old 50s song by Clarence Frogman Henry called I Ain't Got No Home. And he would talk about how homeless people should have an Olympics and they should do the dumpster dive and he had all this cruel stuff he would say about the homeless. Not even to mention all the stuff we got into later with our book and our report with the racism and misogyny.
Well, moving on to another issue of great importance in that period was around abortion. And as most of our listeners know, the Roe v. Wade decision of 1973 legalized abortion in the US, and the response from the far right became an increasingly militant one. Limbaugh proclaimed himself to be pro-life, and in his best-selling book, The Way Things Ought to Be, he denounced pro-choice feminists as feminazis that were on a murderous power trip. Let's hear a segment from that.
Kinds of grief from the pro-choice camp. See, you can't be pro-life and pro-choice at the same time, they said. But I asked them if choice didn't mean having more than one option. I favor saving lives rather than destroying them. I was trying to point out to them that the pro-choice position really isn't accurately described. It means one thing, the promotion of abortion. Consider the way the pro-abortion crowd reacts when people try to counsel a woman against abortion. Why should it matter to the pro-choice radicals if a woman is talked out of an abortion? Say a woman's on her way to Planned Parenthood to have an abortion. Outside their offices, she's stopped by Operation Rescue and told they have a shelter she can go to where she'll be taken care of. She can have the baby. It'll be put up for adoption. But at least it will live. So why are the radical feminists so furious when that happens? What agenda is being harmed? Why get so mad when a woman who planned to have an abortion is talked out of it if choice is really the objective? One reason they get upset is that abortion is the fuel running their entire political agenda. It's the sacrament of their religion of feminism. Here, then, is the definition and real agenda of the feminazi, radical feminists whose objective is to see to it that there are as many abortions as possible. This is their primary mechanism of asserting their power. A second reason some abortion activists get upset is that there's money involved. Abortion's a huge business in this country. Think about 1.5 million abortions a year at, say, $300 each. That's $450 million a year. It's a lot of money being made on abortions. When the French RU486 pill was developed in the early 1980s, it wasn't just the pro-life people who initially opposed it. No, many abortion activists also had qualms about it. They even opposed it. It took abortion out of the clinics where all the money was made and brought it into the privacy of a woman's bathroom. It was only when they realized they couldn't be seen as blocking something like the French pill that they switched sides.
And that
I just
was...
wanted to say, pro-life is a misstatement of the attitude of the people who are anti-abortion. They're not in favor of the lives of the women who have decided not to have a baby.
Rush Limbaugh was very effective in his trying to change the use of terminology and, you know, everything from feminazi, which is like a horrific name calling and totally inaccurate and totally slanderous. How typical was this kind of discussion, Steve Rendall?
Oh, he talked about feminazis every day. And I want to point out, along with what Naomi said, point out that there was another bit of misinformation in the clip that you played, and that is that that feminist or reproductive rights activists want to see as many abortions as possible. No, they want to see as few abortions as possible. They are for education. They are for birth control. They are for family planning. This is the way he got over he was painting them as sociopaths. I mean, basically, they just want to see a lot of dead babies. Will help them bring in the money. And again, I'm not sure how close feminist movements are, how closely they are tied into the profits at abortion clinics. I think that's another. To your question, it was every day. He did this all the time. He'd say feminism was invented to give ugly women a leg up, and he had these little things he went to all the time. And feminazi was one of his a daily buzzword of his.
He didn't do always so well if he was really challenged. Like there, Pat Sajak, is that how you pronounce
yes,
his name?
Right.
He had kind of an encounter with some reproductive rights and AIDS activists. Can you just kind of summarize a little bit how that interaction went?
Yeah, there was a national show on CBS. Pat Sajak had a show for a short time, and he turned it over. I think he was going to turn it over for several days to Rush Limbaugh. I think they were kind of seeing it as a pilot or as a possible tryout for Limbaugh for his own national show. And he got on there, and he was challenged first by a woman on reproductive rights, on abortion. He went into the audience. He stood next to her. She was very, very strong. She really sort of intimidated him. At the same time, in between that, there was, an ACT-UP activist across the audience a bit. You couldn't really tell everything he was saying, but he was definitely challenging Limbaugh too. And Limbaugh sort of retreated back to the desk. And then when he came back on the air, the entire audience had been cleared out of this live situation. It was probably his worst experience as a broadcaster, but he had a certain genius for radio. He was not made for TV. He was certainly not made for anything where anybody could challenge him. He really fell apart. He was basically a house of cards when he got seriously challenged. A lot of people accused his show of, in the call-ins, setting up callers. The callers that he would take that would disagree with him would always be very weak. Later on, he had a show on Fox, not on Fox News, but on Fox broadcast stations across the country, produced by Roger Ailes. This was before Fox, before Roger Ailes would become the head of Fox News. Ailes produced his television show, and that show was very low rent and poorly done. And anyway, radio was his thing.
Tell us about your 1994 report that came out of FAIR.
And
the impact that it had, because it was a fact-based report that was just debunking things. Debunking news.
I convinced my colleagues, we usually looked at television and print news. We almost always did our studies. I was a co-author of many studies at FAIR of reporting. And I convinced my colleagues that it would be good to look at this guy who was having such an impact on the media and in right-wing movements. And so we put together a report, And we did a lot of fact-checking of him, found just dozens of either lies, misinformation, falsehoods that he would broadcast over the air, the bigotry. We did an 8-page magazine report in Fair's magazine Extra, and we put out a press release, and we thought we're going to get back a few clips. We hired a clipping service. In those days, you didn't have the internet, so we hired a clipping service to let us know who had picked up our story about our report. And it was like it was a blockbuster story to the mainstream news. They knew who he was. They wrote about him in the radio columns, but they didn't know he was this lying bigot. And the clipping service, it almost broke us. The AP story that was written, we got 1,200 clips back from newspapers and other outlets that had published our report. And it was fascinating to us because we wanted to know why had he faced no scrutiny from the mainstream media when he was this phenomenon already. And one of the reasons is that a lot of them were complicit with him. He was appearing on Nightline. He was appearing on Meet the Press.
So that sort of stopped it, right?
Our report actually
slowed him down.
Yes. It put a big crimp on him. We even caught on in popular culture. David Letterman started referring to him as the Lion King, LYIN apostrophe. Newt Gingrich stopped appearing regularly on his show. We hurt him. The fact that he was a liar and a bigot did hurt him with some of the more polite quarters of the media.
Well, we've only got 1 minute, and just do you expect his departure to change the right-wing media at all now? And are there any quick lessons you can say about his life and what we can learn from it?
I think the fact that we heard him for a little while in the mid-90s, and he never really fully recovered from that. And I think he got himself into some other trouble with Sandra Fluke, a woman who he called, can I say the word whore on the air? I called her a slut. And he got himself into his own jams as well. But I think by 2002, he had served his purpose. Fox News was now the number one cable news thing. He had served his purpose. He had created a revolution, not only in media, but also in right-wing politics.
Well, thank you so much, Steve Rendall, former director of research at Fairness and Accuracy in Reporting. And I want to thank you for appearing on the show. It's very
interesting. Anytime, John. Anytime. Good to be on BAI.
Thank you. Thank you, Steve.